One, two, three. Why don't you just close your eyes? I just felt this morning, some people are dealing with discouragement and disappointment. And I just felt like God wants to break it off you right now. Discouragement and disappointment. At whatever level that is. But I feel like it's more than just one or two, it's like almost all of us in the room are dealing with some level at that, but I just felt like God say, I just want to break off discouragement. Where God's called you to something and because of what others have said over you, you've shied back. Or what others have done to you, you've shied right back and it's almost crippled you. And God's saying, run, run, run. And you're saying, no, I'm crippled. I can't run. Look at the state that I'm in. But God wants to break that over you this morning. The same with disappointment, where you've tried in the past and you've just been disappointed or let down or things have happened. But God wants to break it off you this morning. So God, right now, wherever that is, whoever that is, whatever situation that is, God, by your Spirit right now. Don't just touch our mind, Jesus, but touch our spirit. Touch our soul. Touch our heart this morning. God, replace it with your grace. That God, even though we don't feel like we deserve it, God, that we can't earn it, you just freely give your grace right now. You give your love, your mercy. God, reinstate courage. Reinstate the appointment where there's been discouragement, where there's been disappointment. God, I pray you replace everything that the enemy has taken. Not just one time over, but seven times over. God, I pray that you release it right now. Release a blessing. Release courage. Release a confidence. To not just walk in their own abilities, but to walk by your purpose, God. That you have called, anointed, and appointed us for such a time as this. To rise up and walk. Take the mat that we've been laying on. To rise up. And walk with purpose, walk with dignity, but walk with courage. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. 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 Come on, let's give God a clap of praise. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. I wear this shirt because I believe it. This is my breakthrough season. And I wear it as a declaration to you as well, that this is your breakthrough season as well. As a church, we've been talking the theme for the year, free people. Free people, if you're visiting with us, man, it's good to have you in church this morning. We're passionate about Jesus. We're passionate about people meeting and being transformed by the real and life-giving power of God. And so, can I encourage you? Don't just listen to words this morning, but tune into what God wants to say to you, what God is doing. And I'm not going to be too long because we're going to baptize these guys this morning and in moments of worship later on. But I just felt this sort of God give me this statement as a church this year. For many of you know, we are in the Free People series, and our core scripture really is Galatians chapter 5 verse 1. And it says, If Jesus has truly set you free, you're free indeed. No, but this is what it says. Then make sure you stay free. That's another scripture in the Bible. It's still truth. But this is the core. If Christ has set you free, then you got to make sure that you stay free. So we've been talking about this whole concept is, yes, Jesus, what Jesus did on the cross, the justification, the removal of the penalty of sin, is in an instant, in an event, in a moment where Jesus transformed your life, but actually the ability to stay free is also the sanctification, the removal of the power of sin over your life. And, you know, you can get removed the penalty, but the power of sin, the grip of sin can still be evident in your life. And that's for many people all through churches all across the world right now. They might know that Jesus has justified them, and they live with the, man, how awesome did Jesus, you know, when we look at Easter Friday coming up, what Jesus did on the cross, yes, it took the penalty of your sin, but man, the power, the residue of sin can still be evident in your world. And so Jesus goes through this process to walk with you in the sanctification and the staying free process of it, to remove the power of it. And then the third area last week we touched on was glorification, is when we meet Jesus, when Jesus comes again, or we pass away and we meet God again. It's called glorification, when the presence of sin has been removed, because you're no longer on this earth. You're no longer tempted like we are in our human form, but we are now reconciled back to the Father in this glorification process that I don't think we'll care about anything that's going on earth, because we'll be flat on our face, worshiping God in true form. How awesome does that sound? But sometimes we thank God for the justification and we look forward to the glorification, but we fail to really do our best at the sanctification part of it. To walk out the journey, to actually live in a process of staying free. But I feel like God gave me this statement for this morning. And all he said was this. He said to me, I want to be a people that aren't just known for our worship, or known for our preaching. We want to be known as a group of people who are hungry for the glory of God. Yeah. Like, we got great worship, we got great preaching, we've got great encouragement for you, but greater than that, man, I want to build a hunger within you, a hunger and thirst after God, greater than just a hunger to be on a team, or a hunger to see different things happen. I want to see you. Man, I'm hungry for God. Man, I'm desperate for God. Man, I've got an expectation this morning that God is going to meet me where I'm at, and things are going to happen. We want to be a people that are hungry after the glory of God. When you come expectant and God is in the room, incredible things can happen. When you come expectant and God is present in the room, look at the Genesis story, the beginning of time where there was darkness, but the Spirit of God was moving. There was expectation from the Spirit of God that God is going to do something. He's about to do something. Something's about to break hold in this place. It's about to break open. And God showed up. He was in the room, and all he did was speak. All he did was start to speak and declare, and what wasn't now is. And he started to separate things, and he started to create different things. And so when we come with an expectation that God is going to move in power, and God comes and meets that expectation, but he blows it out of the water. He meets you there, and then he says, well, if I just did what you want, you'd be okay. But actually, I want to do what I want to do. I want to meet that, but I want to also raise the bar of your expectation. I want to raise the bar of the healing that I can extend to you. You come in just because you want your knee fixed, but actually there's stuff going on the inside that you don't even know, with your lungs and your liver, and I'm going to extend that to you as well. And so God will meet you at your expectation, but he also wants to push past that into the no mind has conceived, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived what God is about to do, what he's doing right now. And we can limit God with our own thinking. We can limit God just into that space of our own information of what we've seen God do before. But actually, God wants you to operate in revelation, where God is downloading things from heaven. That when you, I think I said it last week, is like in our humanity, 1 + 1 = 2. But when God gets in the picture, it's like infinite. You can't even think of what the answer is, because God could just change things up all the time. And I think it's sad that many people in our world live without the presence of God with them. Without the Holy Spirit. Without the helper. But many Christians, actually, we all can sometimes get into, I've got this, God. Just hold off. I've got this. I've got my own abilities. I've got my own strengths. I've got different things. But no, it's actually in our weakness. It's in the areas that we need strengthening, that opens the door to God, for God to come in and be the strength in those moments. Maybe you feel like you don't have courage. Maybe you feel like you don't have confidence. Maybe you feel like you can't step out in different areas. No, it's the God within you. It's the Jesus within you that would speak forth in those moments. That's where you start to see things change. I think the danger in church, within Christian lives, is that has anyone been through a renovation, or like you're possibly in a renovation at the moment? But I used to install kitchens and many new houses, but also renovations. And you know, when you renovate a kitchen, that means you can't cook food. All right. So usually the family or whatever move out for a period of time till they get those things upgraded, and then they can move back in. The challenge is that I looked at this in the sense that justification, what Jesus did on the cross, is like us going, cool, thanks for that, God. Now I need to renovate these things in my life, but only to a point that I can move back in, not till the point where it's finished. Like, God wants to do a finished work in you. But many of us are just trying to move back in before He's finished with the full job. It's like the renovation process is going, and we've actually come back into that space going, hey God, it's all good, I can shower now, I can cook. And He's like, no, it's still under construction, it's still a mess. But no, I've learned to deal with that stuff in my life. I've learned to live with it. So I can live with the little change that you've made in my life, but actually I don't need you to do the rest now, because I can live here. And so when we look at baptism and the going under, the crucified with Christ, all things becoming new, we can look at it in a renovation sort of process of going, okay, God, when I go under, can you please fix this, 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 this? You can do that sort of stuff later. But no, this is a like, this is a old life has passed away, behold, all things becoming new process. So what you planned on living in a renovation is now the mansion you've always dreamed of. It's the things that God has promised you over time, stepping in and actually going out further than you could ever think of. The danger is that we step back into what God is doing in our life too early, and then we take back control that we had given God in the first place. And so have a look in your own life. I've been going through my own life going, okay, God, what are the areas that I feel like you're renovating right now, or you're wanting to make new, and I've just stepped back in and gone, okay, God, for me, it's also the area of purchasing a house. Because, man, I believe God said it. And I believe God wants it for us. But there's areas where I try and take control of that. And I try and find the thing. And I try and, you know, save that little bit of money. And then I do this and I do this. And I cook. Okay, God, now the ingredients are ready. Now make the cake. He's like, actually, there's ingredients that you don't have that I need to supply for that thing to work. But I'm going, no, in my calculations, God, it's time for you to move. It's time for you to get involved and hurry up.
So true. Eh?
None of us are in that boat right now. We can find ourselves in that boat of almost trying to twist God's arm and saying, hurry up, God. I'm sick of waiting. I've been here long enough, God. If you don't do it, I'm never coming back to church. I'm never praying for anyone again. I'm never, and we put these demands on God, and it's like, hang on a minute, God is sovereign. God is God. He could probably stop you from breathing right now, so just be careful, because that's pretty valuable. But a lot of us are in the danger of stepping back in too early on a finished work that God hasn't finished. And we find ourselves then picking up that control again and actually trying to work through that. But the free people that we want to be in God is allowing God to finish what He started. Because He who started a good work is faithful to complete it. If it still looks incomplete or incomplete, then God's not finished. Don't try and twist His arm to say, no, that's enough, God, you're finished. Like, I'm saying it now, God, you're finished. Like, let me jump back in. No, because He's faithful. He's faithful when He starts something that He's going to bring it through to fruition. Get out of the way. Stop trying to butt in to where God is trying to do a work in your life. Because that's the ultimate freedom that you're going after. Who can be free? What a great question. Who can be free? Just Christians? No. God, what Jesus did on the cross wasn't just so that Christians can have a good life. No, it's for every person to be saved. For every single person to have the gap bridged for us to get back to the Father. We look at in Luke chapter 7, you can look at it in your own time. There's a story at the start about a centurion soldier, a Roman centurion. He's like the top rank dude, and he's got a servant that's sick. And then Jesus is working miracles all over the place, and he finds himself getting there, and he sends these two people to go see Jesus and say, hey, can you get Jesus to heal my servant? But there's this transaction that happens, this conversation that happens, and he doesn't even necessarily need to see Jesus himself because he understands authority. He understands that as I would say, go and do this, you can do this, Jesus has that same authority to speak and someone listen and be healed. Miracles are flowing all over the place, and then Jesus comes in contact with that Roman centurion and he says, man, I have not seen greater faith than what you are displaying right now. You understand authority, and you understand that I can do, and I am who I say I am, and all authority given to me is from heaven. And so there's this one interaction Jesus has with this centurion officer, and then later on, I think it's verse 40 or something around there, there's a what the Bible labels as a sinful woman. God, I want my name in the Bible. There you go, sinful woman. No, I want my actual name, Jesus. Nah, it's left out. Now you're just labeled as the sinful woman. Oh, what a sad guy. That's pretty tough, right? But there's a sinful woman, a woman that's known to a whole, like the whole community, the whole city, know this woman who hears that Jesus is at this Pharisee's house. So what does she do? Makes her way into this house, which there's so many customs that she's going against. She's not allowed in there because she's a woman. She's unclean. She's a sinner. There's so many things, but she walks into this house just because she's desperate to have an encounter with Jesus. Because she's desperate. But what does she come in? Not as, hey, you guys all know who I am, I'm coming to do. She just comes in humility. So that was her state. She walks in. She stands behind Jesus and she kneels. Why? Because the custom of the time was that whoever was there at the table, the people that were like down the line of command, the people humility would stand behind, and she bowed in acknowledgement of Jesus' authority and who he was. And he turns around to her, and then all the Pharisees are going, do you want us to remove her out of here? Like, this shouldn't be happening right now. She starts weeping and starts cleaning Jesus' feet with her hair and her tears, and it's like, man, that's a messed up picture right now. But Jesus just holds every one of the Pharisees up and he starts to speak to the woman. You've gone past customs. You've come in your brokenness. You've come in your state of sin, but yet you understand. And so you've got a centurion officer who everyone around was saying, man, if it's anyone Jesus, he deserves it. If anyone Jesus, he deserves your grace. He deserves your mercy. He deserves the love that you have to give. Then you've got a few verses down the track, you've got a woman who definitely does not deserve anything from Jesus as a, like, talking to the crowd, talking to the leaders. And so when you look at that, it doesn't matter what your stature is, what your status is in God, that God will see you and meet you at whatever your point of need is. At whatever and wherever you've been positioned, God will meet you right where you're at. Because ultimately he wants to bring freedom to you, but he also wants to bring freedom to others around you. And so why get free in the first place? Why should we believe that this year we're going to be free? Why should we believe it? Because it's not just for you. Because it's for the people that you meet this week, for the people that are in your world, your friends, your family, the people that are around you that need to know that God is still on the throne, that the Jesus we talk about is not just an Easter Bunny type scenario we've created, no, it was real life events that are recorded, that we believe what Jesus has done on the cross. We believe. See, today, if you didn't know, is Palm Sunday. What is Palm Sunday? Palm Sunday was the week leading up, or the Sunday before, but Jesus was already preparing himself for death, for what he was about to do, and there's a series of events that you can follow this week. It's called the Holy Week. But Palm Sunday was when he turned up into Jerusalem and they all had palm branches and they were putting it down for him to walk and they were shouting Hosanna, they were lifting up Jesus, not knowing that they were probably the ones that were going to crucify him. They were the ones that were going to turn on him. But he starts shouting Hosanna, every single person, they prepared the way for Jesus to come through. And I think, man, God, where have I said Hosanna to you, but then gone around the next couple of days and gone, man, I shouldn't have denied you like that. Jesus, I'm so sorry. Because there's a whole nother sermon in Judas and Peter who both denied Jesus, but one got to see the miracle and one didn't. They all heard the same teaching. They saw the same miracles. Judas sold Jesus out for 30 silver. Peter denied Jesus 3 times. Felt that same pressure. Jesus dies on a cross. Judas goes out and hangs himself. Never gets to see Jesus rise again. Cool thing about Judas was that the custom of those days is you didn't get to choose your rabbi chose you. So Judas didn't go and choose Jesus. No, Jesus chose Judas, even knowing. Jesus chose Judas knowing he was going to be the one to betray him. Knowing he was going to sell him out. Knowing he was probably stealing a whole bunch of money and making smart remarks of, oh, maybe Jesus, we should give it to the poor. Like, rebuked Jesus. Chose Judas, knowing the state that he was in. Guess what? Jesus chooses you. Jesus will still choose you. Jesus would still go to the cross, even though he knows exactly what you've done. This morning, yesterday, last year, 10 years ago, God knows about all that stuff. You can't hide stuff from God. But just like Jesus chose Judas, he chooses you. and he's called you out of that darkness and into his glorious light. You choose. Judas chose not to wait the extra couple of days to see Jesus resurrected. But even in the state of Peter, Peter goes back fishing and everyone thinks, oh, he's backsliding, he's gone back. No, he went back to the first place he met Jesus, where Jesus had called him back in the fishing. In the same scenario, if you look at, I think, John chapter 21, when Jesus turns back up to them in his resurrected state, and he says, hey boys, what are you catching? Oh, we've not caught anything. And you think, man, I read that back in like John chapter 6. But actually, same scenario, but Peter knew that he had to go revisit where Jesus had first talked to him. Maybe you're in this place and you have lost sight of Jesus. Maybe you just need to revisit where you first found him. Might look the same, but the heart is different. Might look the same to the people around you, but the heart is different. Because what God is wanting to do is fresh and new. And not just make things better, but actually make things new. And so that's why I say maybe you're in this place and you want to get baptized this morning. There's extra towels for you. I wasn't sure on what size you were, so I didn't bring clothes for you, but you could get in your clothes. But maybe God's doing something on you. It's not just for those who are prepared. Maybe God's prepared a space for you to get baptized as well. It's totally up to you. Let's stand to our feet. Second Corinthians chapter 5 verse 17 says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have gone, behold, all things have become new. Romans chapter 6 verse 4 says, we were therefore buried with him through baptism into death in order that, just as Jesus was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. And so we're going to baptize these guys this morning. We just found this morning that there was a hole in the baptism tank as well, so you can have a look and see. It's actually deflated quite a lot, so if you hear a whoo, that's because he needs to pump it up before we actually, don't worry, I'll find the hole. But, back to you. You can go ahead, Ian, pump it up, because we need it pumped up. But back to you in what God is doing in your life right now. He who the Son sets free is free indeed. If Christ has truly set you free, then stay free. Like Christ has done his part, now we've got to do our part in the sanctification, the walking out, the journeying with God.